are blessed today, sisters. Now I am honored to introduce to you a singer who's going to come up here from Chicago and sing for us a song that she wrote called Don't Give Up. It's on her new CD that was recently released and is actually for sale back there. Her name is Tina Jenkins Crawley. Come on up, Tina.
How you doing, my sisters? Come on to your feet, are you ready? The Bible says in Galatians 6:9, let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. And that's what this song is. Will you sing my song with me? Will you sing my song with me? I'll teach you. It goes a little something like this. Are you ready? Today's a day when life could pass me by. Oh, the wind is blowing. I'm looking at the sky. Could I ever get past this loneliness and blues? I tell myself every day, don't give up. It's okay, slow it down. Don't give up today. No, no. Here's your part.
Don't give up.
No, no, no.
Today.
I'll be picking up the pieces. My troubled heart fade away. I'm looking for some help, a simple peace inside. Hear me, Lord, as I pray, change my heart, God away. Make me strong, find a way. So find a way.
Oh, don't give up.
So rain, rain, Lord, shake all the clouds away. Oh, sun, sun,
shine on me.
Make me all that I could be. Cause a lie, blessings overflow my cup. Head, head, hold up high. Spread my wings and touch the sky. Cause I won't give up.
I've been trying to reach you.
Oh, you look just the same.
You do too.
Such a feeling's coming over me. There is wonder in most everything I see. Not a cloud in the sky, got the sun in my eyes, and I won't be surprised if it's a dream. I'm on the top of the world.
This is the end, my only friend, the end of our elaborate plans. The
journey of life, perseverance always wins out in the end. Amen, sisters! My name is Irene Renton, and I am from the church in Johannesburg. I studied the Bible as a teenager back in the day and was baptized as a campus student 22 years ago. And today I want to share with you a few thoughts I have on perseverance. And I want to share with you one of my new spiritual heroes. So turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew 15. If you have a Bible, or turn on your Bible, or whatever you do, Matthew 15. In verse 21, the Bible says, "Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from the vicinity came to him crying out, 'Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is suffering terribly from demon possession.' Jesus did not answer a word, so his disciples came to him and urged him, 'Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us.' He answered, 'I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel.' The woman came and knelt before him, 'Lord, help me,' she said. He replied, 'It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to their dogs.' 'Yes, Lord,' she said, 'but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table.' Then Jesus answered, 'Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted.' And her daughter was healed from that hour." You know, the Bible says that Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. This is the first time in Jesus' adult life that he actually left Israel. Jesus needed some time out. And it's here that this Canaanite woman comes to Jesus. And she's begging him, she's crying out to him, she's saying, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And the Bible says that Jesus pays no attention to her. He ignores her. Can you imagine the scene, sisters? This woman is, "Oh, Jesus, help me." She's begging and crying. The disciples are looking at Jesus, begging and crying to send her away. And Jesus is like, "I don't hear anything. I don't see anything." And yet this woman persevered. I don't know about you, but I've got a lot to learn from this woman. You know, she needed to overcome several obstacles in order to persevere. The first obstacle she could have faced is, "Jesus doesn't care about me." You know, Jesus was not paying attention to her. He didn't seem interested. Can you relate? Have you ever had a time in your life where it feels like, "Hello, God, I'm here"? You know, my younger sister is a disciple. I know there was a time in my life where it honestly felt like every time I prayed, it was like God was like, "Oh, la, la, I can't hear you." And then, you know, she would come to me and say, "Oh, you know, Irene, I prayed about this." And it's just amazing how God just answered it straight away. And I'm like, "Really?" So I was tempted at that time to slip her my prayer list. "Here we go. Maybe he'll listen if you pray." But you know, we can feel at times like God doesn't hear us. He answers other people's prayers, but he's not answering my prayer. You know, in times like that, I've wondered, have I done something wrong? Is there some kind of secret sin in my life that I haven't actually dealt with? You know, this woman just persevered. She just kept crying out. You know, the first step in perseverance, sisters, is that we got to keep crying out. Are you still crying out today? Maybe you're feeling like God is not answering your prayers, but have you stopped crying out? We must persevere in crying out to God. We need to persevere in crying out to God for the lost, for our families, for our friends, for our husbands, those we have and those we want, right? For our children, those we have and those we want, for the character changes that we need to make. You know, maybe for you it's your work situation or your finances. I don't know what it is for you, but sister, are you still crying out? You know, I know that there are women in this room today that you are on the verge of losing your faith. And maybe for you, coming to this conference was sort of a last bit attempt to say, you know, I'm going to hold on to my faith and I'm going to, let me come and maybe something will happen. You know, I can relate. You know, I became a campus student and really it was not glorious. Those first few years were kind of scary for me spiritually. And, you know, I got to the point where I just felt like, I can't do this. I can't, God. I want to do this, but I can't. I you know when people tell you, you've got a lot of potential? I hate that. I don't want to have potential. Potential means you're not actually doing anything, but you could be doing something. I hated potential. I don't want to have potential. And, you know, I went through a time where I just honestly felt like I'm a failure. I can't change. People don't believe in me. I don't believe in myself. What is the point of this? And so what I did is I actually went into a forest, and I went there and I was going to tell God goodbye. Thanks. I really wish I could be a disciple, but I actually can't. And, you know, I stood in this forest and I was praying and I was crying and I just said to God, you know, maybe another time in my life, but I just can't do this. I can't overcome the sin in my life. I can't do this. I want to, but I can't. And, you know, something in my spirit told me to look down. And I looked down and what I'd been looking at is this forest, and I've been saying to God, you know, I look at these fern trees and they're so huge and they provide shade and they provide a resting place for birds. And I wish I could be that for you spiritually, but I can't. I'm so weak. I'm so pathetic. And I felt in my spirit to look down and there I saw this tiny little fern tree. The daughter or the child of this tree. And I looked down and I thought, you know what? If that little fern will just stand its ground, it can become this great tree. And you know, that day I remember thinking, you know what? If no one else believes in me, God does. And I'm here to tell you today, sister, that maybe today you don't even believe in yourself, but God believes in you. Maybe you feel like no one believes in me, but God believes in you. Do you believe in him enough to cry out, even when you don't feel heard? Sisters, we cannot stop crying out. This woman didn't stop crying out. You know, the disciples get irritated with her, and they say, Jesus, send her away. And you know, Jesus responds, he says, I was sent only for the lost sheep of Israel. The second obstacle that she needed to overcome was maybe what I'm asking for is not in God's will. Now hear me, she was living outside of the borders of Israel. She was not Jewish. We know later that Paul would come and preach to the Gentiles. So for now, she wasn't part of God's plan. Her life was not a part of God's will right now. And yet that didn't deter her. She was unmoved by that. She just kept persevering. You know, sometimes we can think, you know, maybe what I'm praying for is not God's will, so I'm just going to, you know, surrender it to God, and I'm just, you know, whatever he wants. Now, if you are praying with great perseverance for a Ferrari or to win the national lottery, I'm not saying God can't answer that, and you probably want to get some input in your life. But you know, sisters, the way I feel about life is just open every door. Some of us are standing around waiting, oh God, open a door for me, show me what to do. My attitude is open every door and let God close the doors. We should be praying, not sitting around waiting to see what God is going to do. And my encouragement is, you know, whether you know it's in God's will or not, we need to be on our knees praying. She wasn't moved. You know, I would have been tempted at this stage when Jesus said to me, said to her, you know, I only came for the lost sheep of Israel. I would have been tempted to say, okay, well, amen, I tried, amen. I gave it my best shot. Sorry about that. And walked away. This woman was like, yeah, probably not, huh? I don't know why it's not part of your plan right now, but actually I need you right now, and my daughter is suffering, so yeah, I'm just going to keep going. I love her attitude. She finally gets on her knees. She gets on her knees and she says, Lord, help me. How does Jesus respond? It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to their dogs. No, he didn't. Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, meek and mild, did not just say that. You know, I have always struggled with this verse. I have always been like, I don't know. I can't believe I'm at a conference preaching on this verse, because it's always been a struggle. Now, the thing is that scholars say that this was actually a common phrase that Jews use. You know, it's like in Texas. In Texas, you say everything is bigger in Texas, right? It's not necessarily true, and it's not necessarily what we believe. It's just a saying. And so Jesus was throwing out this saying. That's right, you Texans. But Jesus was truly testing her with this statement. In fact, the whole encounter was a test. You know, the final obstacle that she needed to persevere through was, now I am hurt, and enough is enough. How would you have responded? Would you have been angry, bitter, upset? If this is the kind of God you are, then I want nothing to do with you. You know, maybe you feel, I deserve better treatment than this. God is not treating me fairly. I have humbled myself. I have kept crying out. And now it's time for God to do his part. You know, in South Africa, we say, have a saying, God needs to come to the party. You know, and yet how does this woman respond? She says, yes, Lord, but even the dogs eat the scraps that fall from the master's table. I mean, how humble. How humble. You know, she does not feel entitled. She does not feel that she deserves anything or she is owed anything from God. She doesn't understand all of what's going on, but you know, she trusts in God's compassion. She trusts in his love and in his mercy. And Jesus responds, he says, woman, you have great faith. And her daughter was healed from that hour. You know, in the Spider-Man movie, it says there's a saying, right? With great power comes great responsibility. I'm here to tell you, sister, with great humility comes great perseverance. If you're struggling to persevere today, I want you to check your pride. You know, you will find the place, you will find the faith and the strength to persevere in the place where God is the only option. And all other options, including your own pride and your own ego, are out the door. Where you hang on to God and you trust God and you believe in God and you say, God, I don't understand what's going on in my life, but I trust you and I will not give up. And you get on your knees before the throne of God and you say, Lord, help me. Where you don't feel entitled or what you deserve or what you should be given and who does God think he is and isn't he? I mean, come on, God. Where you are humble before God. You know, there's a saying that you cannot humiliate the humble. Maybe you need to write that down. Sometimes, my encounter with that sister, I feel so humiliated. Let me tell you, you cannot humiliate the humble. This woman was not humiliated by this encounter with Jesus. It's her humility that allowed her to be blessed by this encounter with Jesus. Your humility, sisters, is what's going to allow you to persevere. And I pray that today you feel that. You know, I want to close out with sharing about a sister, Julia, in the church in Cape Town. What an amazing sister. She was a single woman, I love the singles ministry. Amen. I love the singles ministry. Woo! She was a single woman, and she dated a brother. Amen. And they got married. Wonderful. Then they had a child. Amazing. Living the dream. But, you know, her husband did very poorly spiritually and actually fell away and filed for divorce. And then one day they were driving in a car, and he and their child that he had for the weekend were both killed in the car accident. So here she is. I mean, she has nothing. She's been stripped. You know, then she persevered. I mean, I asked her, what made you persevere? She said she just kept feeling like Satan is not going to get me. Satan is not going to. I believe God. I believe God. I believe God. You know, she ended up starting to date, which was wonderful. But then she was only 37 years old. Then she developed breast cancer. And so she was dating now, and she had to go through, you know, the chemo and the radiation, and they told her, you will never have children. And, you know, she just said, I'm not going to let Satan win. I'm going to trust God no matter what. You know, amazingly, they got married, and it was an amazing miracle. And they fell pregnant, and now she is married with a son. And I just... You know, sisters, we just need to stand sometimes. We need to stand and take our ground and get humble before the throne of God and cry out. What are the areas that you need to persevere in? I want you to think about it. I want you to pray about it. Where do you need to get up and pray and ask God to help you to persevere? Sometimes it's when life doesn't make any sense. We just have to persevere. Our perseverance starts in our walk with God. How are you in God today? Are you happy? Are you bitter? Are you frustrated? Do you feel like God shows favor to me? You need to deal with those issues. Right now, I'm going to introduce you to Caroline, my friend from India, and she's going to share her story on perseverance. Amen.
Thank you, Irene. Good morning, sisters. My name is Caroline George, and I've been a disciple for 23 years and been in the ministry for 22 long years. Now, my journey of perseverance started the day I got baptized. And there has been many milestones of change that have marked my journey in life as a Christian, as I have tried to understand the role of being a godly disciple, a godly wife, mother, friend, and a leader. Now, there was one weakness that plagued me for many years of my Christian life and still does. And that is my negativity. I got much discipling and much input in this area, but I kept finding myself coming back to square one all the time. You know, it really made me feel very hopeless. I felt stuck, and I felt like, you know, I just couldn't move on. I got very angry sometimes with people who brought it up, frustrated, sometimes tired and weary of working on the same thing again and again. And you know, sometimes I felt like, you don't understand. You know, this is so hard. Have you felt that way about something? So I was able to see, though, that over a period of time that this weakness of mine was affecting my relationships with people, especially those who was close to me, and that is my family. But what I failed to see was that there were many things that were contributing to this weakness, and that it was not only affecting my spiritual life, but it was also damaging my physical health and also mentally. So, when my gynecologist told me in 2007 that I needed to have a hysterectomy done and asked me to find another job, or she told me, go find a counselor, go do yoga so you can deal with the stress in your life, I was like, whoa. You know, I sat up and started thinking seriously about my life. And I thought, if as a Christian, I could not feel the peace that passeth all understanding that God had promised me, then there was something definitely wrong with the way I was living my Christian life. So I decided I was going to embark on a journey of self-awareness to see why I was not able to receive and own God's promises in my life. As a Christian, I knew fully well that the Word of God will reflect like a mirror what was inside me and show me what I really look like from the inside. So through my Bible studies, I was able to understand that I was rejecting God's Word and holding on to my own past experiences, my own understanding, my own feelings as the gospel for my life instead of God's Word. And you know, I became aware of the fact that, unlike the Syrophoenician woman, who was completely willing to depend on God for direction and solution, I still wanted to be in control of my life. And you know, really, I was still the Lord of my life. Now, I went to God with my own solutions and expected Him to work it out for me. Now, that was not what you call surrender. And you know, I also realized that I was setting very high standards for myself and trying to work everything out on my own strength and my own energy and failing miserably. And instead of leaving things in God's hand, I was trying to take charge and take control. And as what I could do was very limited as a human being, I kept constantly failing and falling short. And this made me very insecure, very unhappy, very discontent, discouraged. You know, nothing seemed good enough. Everything was very negative. And I got very negative about myself and others as well. Now, during this time, my daughter, who was 19 years old, was studying the Bible as well, and she studied for 6 years continuously, but was not making the decision to get baptized. And I remember one day she sitting down to talk to me about how she felt around me. She said, "Mom, you know what? I can never feel good enough around you. I always feel like I'm not up to the mark." Whoa. You know, I didn't even realize the damage that I was doing to the people around me, the ones that loved me, that were close to me. And I was so blind to how I was functioning. And you know, I realized that emotionally, this had distanced her from me. And you know, slowly, God made me open my eyes and see the damage that I was doing to the people that I loved. And because of my lack of change and my lack of self-awareness, you know, I was doing a lot of damage to people. And as I continued on this journey, I was able to realize that my life was all about me. What I could do, what I could achieve, how I could prove myself, how I want to be accepted and understood. And you know, I desperately needed God in my life. But the I in me was so big that I was shutting God out and not letting Him work in my life. Now, I can show the whole world how wonderful and powerful I am as a leader, but it's the people around me who really know who I am. The people that I am with every single day, they are the ones who really know who I am on the inside. And it is they I needed to listen to. And they were the ones God was going to use to work in my life to help me to change. And you know, as I grew in this awareness, the way I prayed changed. You know, as I understood through the scriptures, I got more, understood God's mercy, His love, His kindness. I started getting more real with God. And that made me go to God being more humble, you know, as Irene was talking about, rather than going in my strength and acting like I know everything and I can do everything and I can be something or somebody. And you know, understanding His grace, His mercy, experiencing it in my life and making it real is what led me to repentance eventually. And I learned that the beginning of all change comes when I'm humble and humble enough to accept that I'm nothing. And that God needs to become everything, just like this woman understood. And you know, God must become greater, and I needed to become lesser. And you know what? As I understood these things, and you know, I was really broken on the inside, but I was able to have the courage, the faith, and the strength to make the change that God wanted me to make. I was able to make that emotional connection with my daughter. And you know, my efforts at making changes encouraged and gave her faith as well to not give up, but to keep trying in her journey of trying to get to know God. You know, as I understood these things, I was able to understand other people's pain better. I was able to repair the damage in my relationship with other people as well. And as I understood these things, I started getting more positive about myself as I saw how God was allowing me to change and become stronger, and it was not in my hands. What was impossible with me was possible with God. And you know what, sisters? I thank God for his work in my life, but his work is not over. It will last all my lifetime, and the journey continues. Amen? And it is in his hands. It's not over. And I'm very happy to say my daughter got baptized last month, and that was glorious. And, you know, thank God for his work in my life that I can pass faith on to others. To God be the glory. Amen.
Good morning, sisters. I don't know how you're doing, but I am having a marvelous time. This is incredible. I bring you love and greetings from the New York Church. Amen. I want to begin my time with you this morning by watching this video from the movie Taken.
Dad!
Oh, my darling. Happy birthday.
Dad, guess what? You know my friend Amanda?
Yep.
Her cousins asked us to spend vacation with them in Paris. I really, really want to go. Hi, Daddy.
You were supposed to call me when you left.
There's someone here.
What?
Oh my God, they got Amanda. They got me.
All right, listen to me. Go to the next bedroom, under the bed.
Tell me when you're there.
Now, the next part is very important. They're going to take you. I don't know who you are. I don't know what you want. If you are looking for a ransom, I can tell you I don't have money. But what I do have are a very particular set of skills. Skills I have acquired over a very long career. Skills that make me a nightmare for people like you.
Where are they?
If you let my daughter go now, that'll be the end of it.
You have a 96-hour window.
What?
To never find her.
No.
But if you don't, I will look for you.
Where is she?
I will find you. I will kill you.
Good luck.
Most of us can imagine what it would feel like to have a child or a loved one taken or kidnapped. Their capture would greatly impact the focus of our life. In fact, our mission would become to find that child and to bring them back home where they belong. In 2 Timothy 2, verses 24 through 26, we read, "And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Opponents must be gently instructed in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the devil, who has taken them captive to do his will." God's children and our future brothers and sisters have been taken captive by the devil. In Revelations 12, verses 7 through 9, "Then war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back, but he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down, or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him." This passage teaches us that the devil is leading the whole world astray. Even as Christians, we are not immune to Satan's deception. Even though Christians are not of the world, right, Christians? We are still in the world. And Satan can lead us astray. How does he do that? Through complacency, through preoccupation with our own lives, our own struggles, our own circumstances. Satan uses these struggles to distract us from a faithful focus on God, because he knows our faith in God frees us from worry and fear about our own lives, so that we can see the needs and suffering of the lost people around us. As of March 12, 2012, the United States Census Bureau estimated that there are over 7 billion humans on this planet. As Christians, we know that every human being was knit together in their mother's womb by the hand of God. We know that Jesus died on the cross for everyone to have a way out of sin and into the arms of God. We know that every person is loved by God, and God wants his children who have been taken captive by the devil to be rescued, to be saved, to be brought back to him. Does somebody have some water down there that I could get really quickly? If you have seen the movie Taken, you have to admire the role that Liam Neeson plays in regard to his daughter. 1 minute. That doesn't usually happen to me. I guess the devil doesn't want me to tell you these things. All right, so Liam Neeson, his role, his attitude toward his daughter. As you watch that movie, what do you see? He is determined and ready to use everything at his disposal to find his child. Here is what he says to her captors. I don't know who you are. I don't know what you want. If you are looking for ransom, I can tell you that I don't have money. But what I do have are a very particular set of skills. Skills that I have acquired over a very long career. Skills that make me a nightmare for people like you. If you let my daughter go now, that will be the end of it. But if you don't, I will look for you. I will find you, and I will kill you. Now, I know there's a lot that could be said about that statement, right? But today, I want to focus on one part of it. It's where he says, I don't have money, but what I do have are a very particular set of skills, skills that I have acquired over a very long career. We also have a very particular set of skills for carrying out the mission of winning the world. For time's sake, we will not be able to talk about all of these skills, but we'll talk about one, and that skill is love. Love must be at the heart of everything that we do. In Matthew 22, verses 36 through 39, Jesus is asked this question, Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? He replied, Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. That is our purpose in life. That is the greatest and the most important thing that we will ever do in our life, is to love God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, to love God with all of our being. And when we love God this way, we want to please him. When we love God this way, we want to make him happy, and we want to give him what he wants. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3, we read, This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. Seeing people saved and coming to a knowledge of the truth makes God happy. It pleases God. The heart of the mission is to love God and to love others the way that we love ourselves. Because we love God, and let me say that again, because we love God, we embrace the mission of seeking and saving the lost, helping God's children who are trapped and enslaved by the devil. God certainly wants us. He adores us. We are the apple of his eye. But God also wants his other children who have not made it back home yet. You know, the truth is, we didn't make it back to God by ourselves, and neither will they. The mission must become personal for us again. That is where loving others as much as we love ourselves comes in. What if it were your child that was taken? What would you do? It wouldn't matter that the world is large, that the task is great, or that you have your own personal issues to deal with. Your lost child becomes the major priority of your life. Your lost child would never be far from your heart, your mind, your efforts to bring them back home. That is the heart of God toward every lost person in this world. If our child were taken, we would pray more. We would ask more questions. We would never stop looking. We would never give up, because we know as long as there is life, there is hope. We'd be urgent, eager to do whatever was needed. Angie Gentile has been a disciple for over 12 years. Her husband became a Christian before Angie did, and they were raising their two young daughters together in the church. 8 years ago, Angie found out that she had breast cancer. During that time, her husband fell away. Angie found herself in the middle of very challenging circumstances. Angie was determined not to lose her faith in God. She persevered over the last 8 years through Bible study, prayer, and consistent evangelistic outreach. Angie died on May 11th of this year. Before Angie died, she saw her husband restored to the Lord. Amen. Her 15-year-old daughter became a disciple, and her neighbor started studying the Bible. Angie never stopped loving God and loving those around her. As daughters of God, we must love him and give him what he wants. I want to close with a video of the very thing that brings God great joy.
Our God is an awesome God, and he wants everyone to be saved. In Matthew 28:19, we are instructed to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amber Phillips is a 15-year-old who was raised around the church. For over a year, Amber studied out the nature of God. Inspired by the changes they have seen in Amber's life, three other teens are now studying the Bible. During the 2012 spring semester, the Campus Student Initiative in the South Florida Church saw four new sisters baptized from four different campuses that previously had no disciples before. Marissa Perez is a single mom who is also a nursing student. While Marissa was studying the Bible, there were many challenges to making Jesus Lord of her life. Marissa came to know in her heart that nothing in this life is more important than being close to Christ. Very few things are more exciting than seeing lost souls escape the trap of the devil and enter the kingdom of God. Thank God for every soul that has been won for Christ, but the harvest still remains plentiful. As disciples, we must be the workers.